Good evening. Thank you for giving me this opportunity again. It's always nice to be back at the Coromandel branch. See, DBT is not uncommon. So I think we should get that clear, that many people seem to feel that DBT does not occur in India, which is not true. If you keep your eyes open, you will find enough and more DBT.
Last one.
See, I'm going to skip some basic stuff. I'm just going to talk only on the treatment part. It's important to know the complications of DBT, especially the proximal DBT. Proximal, I mean, is iliofemoral DBT. So we have acute complications like pulmonary embolism. And then when the DBT is too extensive, you can develop what is called a venous gangrene, where all the veins outflows are occluded and it ultimately leads to gangrene. What's important to realize is fatal pulmonary embolism is responsible for in-hospital death in around 10 to 15%. It is proven world over. It has been proved in India also. I'm from PGI, so we used to do autopsy for all the patients, and we have shown that 15% of the deaths, in-hospital deaths, all due to pulmonary embolism. And you can see here a large pulmonary embolus sitting, including the right pulmonary artery. And the other important thing is when the patient presents with pulmonary embolism, nearly 80% of the patients do have the source of the clot from the legs, from the DBT. And another important thing is 50% of the 50% of the proximal DBTs produce pulmonary embolism. They may not be even clinically able. If you start doing CTs for all these patients, you will pick up pulmonary embolism. So it's very, very important that we treat these patients properly. And 80% of the DBT in the patients who present with pulmonary embolism may be just silent, may not even show evidence of deep vein thrombosis. And you see that the next important complication is like a venous gangrene. A patient with what we traditionally used to call as phlegmasia cerulea dolens. That is, a patient, the entire venous outflow is occluded, and you find the genitalia is swollen up, blisters have started. It's just a few hours away from developing massive gangrene. This is another girl who had this. So the only thing we could offer at that time was operation and hopefully we'll be able to limit the amount. So it's very important that we treat this iliofemoral DBTs properly. And there are some chronic complications in these patients, and some of them can present with chronic pulmonary venous hypertension, recurrent pulmonary embolism, small emboli, choking up the pulmonary arterial tree, and ultimately causing pulmonary vascular hypertension. And the second thing is on the limb, chronic venous hypertension, or what is called the post-traumatic syndrome, which is quite debilitating. If you see one of these patients, you will realize how difficult the patient leads a life. And the incidence of post-traumatic syndrome is practically 100% when you wait longer. By the time it's about 5 to 10 years after DBT, the post-traumatic syndrome is nearly 100% because all of them end up having valvular damage in these patients. So like you see this man is actually a bank officer. He dresses the wound and goes to his office, and by the time afternoon, his pant is wet. The bandage is wet, there is so much of soakage from here, the pant is wet, and the man has tried committing suicide a couple of times because of the depression, because nothing could be done in those days. This is actually a old slide. Nowadays, we are able to offer something for him. And this is another patient who's had multiple surgeries for the leg, for the fracture, and the DBT was never treated, and he ended up with this kind of a problem. And this is another patient, you can see classically, multiple scars doing surgery for the fracture femur, but what is troubling him is the ulcer and pain and the limb swelling. So The post-traumatic leg is a very, very serious problem. So what is the aim of treatment in DVT? Is to dissolve the thrombus, avoid pulmonary embolism, prevent the gangrene, and preserve valve function. That's very, very important. And thereby preventing post-traumatic leg in these patients. And how do we achieve that? The classical treatment is that we always used to use heparin, the unfractionated heparin, which should be not be given as a stat doses, which used to be a practice, give 5,000 units heparin 6 hours. That's not correct. It should be given as a continuous infusion with something like 1,000 units per hour and with the APCP control of 2 to 2.5 times the baseline. But it used to be cumbersome. You have to do the, you need a pump, you need somebody to monitor and all that. And the next thing that came is the low molecular weight heparin, which can be given twice a day, or even there are fondaparin, the newer ones, which can be given as a single dose. And then is the standard the vitamin K analogs, the oral anticoagulant, overlap of 3 to 5 days, and you here the problem is you need to give you need to do the PTINR and have to maintain it between 2 and 3 to reach optimal levels, and then this is given for 3 to 6 months, and now we have the newer oral anticoagulants which are the direct thrombin inhibitors. But when you look at the effect of treating DVT, especially proximal DVT with all this, what happens? Nearly 95% of the patients have valvular dysfunction, 90% have venous hypertension, 70% with an obstructed hyperplane lesion, and corpus muscle dysfunction, venous claudication, ulceration, and all that. Isolated iliac vein thrombus, which we rarely see, they have a better prognosis than the classical iliofemoral DVT. So, actually, even though we are treating vigorously, the clot may go, but the damage to the valve is done. And many of these patients, they have hypertension by 5 years, and 90% suffer from post-traumatic leg, like what we have seen. So hence, the newer advancement that came was trying to remove the thrombus, thereby limiting the damage. So there are various methods. You see here, the patient was being fully treated with anticoagulation, and this is a MR venogram. You see here, this is the femoral vein with a profunda vein, and you can see here the entire iliac vein is completely diseased. So this man presents with the leg swelling, starts developing a venous ulcer and eczema. This is yet another patient. You can see here, the entire iliac vein is gone, and extensive collaterals have been developing, and there are changes in the femoral vein lower down also. So, what are the other methods of improving this treatment? We have surgical thrombectomy, catheter directed thrombolysis, and percutaneous mechanical thrombectomy devices, which are also coming to move. And surgical thrombectomy here is when in immediate thrombosis, like the patient I showed with phlegmasia, ferugia dolens, that we can't be waiting. Even the thrombolytic therapy will take some time. There you have to open up the vein, remove the thrombus, and try to relieve the venous hypertension. So thrombectomy is done through the transfemoral route using special balloon catheters, and then at the end of it, we use some AV fistulas to keep the flow going. And the distal thrombus is literally extracted by using something like an S-marsh bandage. We try to suck out and remove the thrombus as much as possible. But is it effective? Advantages are immediate decompression, it can prevent the gangrene, and results are better than heparin therapy. But the disadvantage is you can still squeeze up a pulmonary embolism. So probably you have to put a filter to prevent that before doing this. Evidence of rethrombosis is pretty high. And you cannot save the valves really by doing this procedure. So what is the next thing that came is the catheter-directed thrombolysis. Here, there is no role for systemic thrombolysis. There is no point in giving an IV and giving urokinase through a peripheral line. There's no point in doing that. That's only for pulmonary embolus. When you're treating with DVT, it is done as a catheter-directed thrombolysis. That is, you have to put a catheter into the femoral vein and then dissolve the clot. The way we do is patient is put pro, operative vein is cannulated. We put an infusion catheter into the operative vein, try to aspirate as much as blood as possible, keep an infusion catheter and continuously give. We usually use this TPA and we do venograms every 12 hours and infusion is continued till the thrombus is fully dissolved. Usually it takes to from 24 to 48 hours and then you put the patient on more anticoagulants. Like you see here, the patient is prone, the popliteal vein is punctured, a sheath is put. This is the catheter we use for aspiration. See, like so much of aspiration is done immediately, and then there are special infusion catheters. We keep them and do the lysis. Here you can see here, you staged initially the entire iliac ring is choked. You can see here, then after starting the treatment, you can see some flow, some residual thrombus still. 24 hours is much better, 36 hours, little bit here and there it's stuck, but then the flow is pretty good. And this man, later, you can see here, very nice flow. Now, this is done in the, not in the prone position, in the supine position, that's why the right left side, you can see here, the flow is excellent. So the complete clot lysis and fair amount of valve preservation is done with this, since we don't disturb the valves in these. So the advantages, in successful lysis is achieved in about 80 to 90%, 70%, here also we cannot say 100% that we can preserve the valve function, but 70% have normal valve function and significant better quality of life. So CDT should be the treatment of choice for acute iliofemoral DVT unless there is specific contraindication for the lytic therapy. There is another method that has come, is the percutaneous mechanical thrombectomy. Well, we have special devices. Here also, we push the catheter into the thrombus. There are devices which rotate, they lyse the thrombus and also suck it up. Here, the very quick reduction in edema and relief of symptoms, aspiration of the clot by that, and little bit of lytic therapy is also given in addition to that. And then the clot is lysed and sucked out immediately. So it reduces hospital stay and reduces the bleeding complication. But there are some disadvantages, that there is a risk of endothelial damage, fragmentation and PE is known. And then hemolysis, because since you are churning the clot, you produce hemolysis, so you have to be prepared for that. And these machines are expensive. Then a word about IVC filter. IVC filters are widely misused, especially in the United States. The indications for IVC filters are very, very strict and limited. And that is the progression of the thrombus in spite of adequate heparin. Without giving heparin, there's no point in putting an IVC filter just because somebody has an iliofemoral DVT. The incidence of pulmonary embolism is very, very less. It's not that high. So patient should receive adequate heparin in spite of that the thrombus is progressing, or you cannot give contraindication to heparin. Suppose somebody has a huge pelvic fracture or a GA bleed malignancy, there you can't give any anticoagulation. There you put the filter, do the surgery, remove the tumor, and then start the anticoagulation. And large PE requiring intervention. That is, patient primarily presents with a huge PE and shock. You are forced to do either a lytic therapy or doing surgery. In such a situation, you can't afford to have another PE, so you put a filter to prevent that. Like you see here, there are many filters that have come. But what is the change in that is, earlier we used to put the picture that I showed is of a permanent filter. Permanent IVC filter induces thrombus and IVC occlusion in a large percentage of patients over a period of time. So we have decided not to put any permanent filters. The present day filters are all temporary retrievable filters. You put them and you retrieve them after about 12 weeks, by which time you expect that the risk of pulmonary embolism is reduced, it's gone. So you remove the filter after that, and these are the things that are done now. And a recent, even more recent advancement is this filter. This is a metal which will stick to the IVC, and this part, which is the umbrella inside, the fiber inside, is made of a bioabsorbable filament. So over a period of time, this filament disappears, and all you have is the outer skeleton, which will be stuck to the IVC wall. So thereby, there is no thrombus. It is just undergoing clinical trial, so which will come through. words about Mehta syndrome. Maybe you might have seen yourself that majority of the IVs, DVTs that we see are on the left side. Why does it happen? Because iliac vein is crossed by the right common iliac artery, and there is an element of compression between the artery and the vertebra, and the iliac vein gets compressed. So the web or band formation occurs more common in females, also seen on the right side, but much more on the left side. You see here the typical Mehta syndrome, where this is the impression of the iliac artery on the iliac vein, and this vein has been compressed. Even though it looks okay, in one plane it looks like this, but you see the lateral view, the lumen is so small, it has been compressed. So that is why the left iliac DVT is much more common. And this is how it looks like. The iliac artery crosses the iliac vein at this point. You can also have a compression here and another compression at this point. But this is the most common one. And it can present without as just an edema, varicose vein, and sometimes with acute DVT. And you see here a patient who presented with the DVT completely gone, entire leg is filled. So we are doing a catheter directed thrombolysis. The lysis has happened, you can see some flow. And after this iliac, there is a total occlusion of the spot. So the iliac vein there is totally gone. So what do we do for that? Now we have venous stents. So we can do a stenting of the iliac vein up to the IVC. And you see here now there is a free flow of contrast into the IVC. And some of these patients, like the patient I showed, post-lovenic leg, they are all due to iliac vein not cleared and iliac vein getting occluded. Present day, we can do a stenting for the iliac vein. Some of these patients, this patient had a DVT nearly more than 10 years ago. And now the newer advancement, we are able to offer treatment for him with presented with post-lovenic leg. And we were able to put a dilate this track and put stents right up to the IVC. You can see here now the free flow of contrast and all the collaterals have disappeared. So to conclude, ladies and gentlemen, cough vein and femoral DVT is to be managed with anticoagulation, whereas iliofemoral DVT, catheter-directed thrombolysis is the ideal one. And any stenosis in the iliac vein can be managed by plasty or stenting. This reduces later-day mortality. Thank you very much.
The hallmark of a good speaker is he stops before time. Sometimes
I got a phone call 20 minutes. Now you are out.
Sometimes we have to keep on remaining, and they ask to like a court la vaida vaar mari idu ranjan shun idu ranjan shun solava. So I request Dr. Sina to hand over the certificate of appreciation. Thank you for the wonderful speech by Dr. Sekar.
Sir, what is
the
oral VK you
have
written?
Yeah,
what
this thing? Vitamin K analogs.
The
lighting
solution is
the one. No, we are using urokinase also. Depending on the person, the patient. Urokinase is slightly cheaper. DPA is costly.